lectures entitled Story of the Buddhist Hill, Part 1 of 2 on Between Master and Disciples, given in English on August 15, 2021.
Hi, lovely people, all of you in the whole wide world. My greetings and best wishes to you. Here is another story to cheer you up. Perhaps this is from a Vietnamese folklore.
We thank Liu Huynh, Đặng Văn Lung, who have selected and compiled the book of the Vietnamese folklore. And we thank Hợp Tuyển Truyện Cổ Tích Việt Nam team for these beautiful stories. We thank also all the collectors, compilers, and writers who have contributed to this work. May you be blessed. We wish you the best. God bless. Please ask somebody to contact them for the permission to read the stories. All the stories now and in the future, and compensate the cost of printing and all the involved costs for this. Thank you.
It's about the past, names, and Buddhist past. Long time ago, there were four people who were Buddhist and very, very faithful. And very, very diligent in their practice. That is, day and night, they try very hard to recite the Buddha's teaching and recite the Buddha's name in the determination to become Buddha. All four of them have different names, of course. But one of them is a lady, a nun. After many decades of reading Buddha Sutra and reciting Buddha's names and prayers and being vegan and just truly staying in the temple and practicing part, whatever they think they should. So all of them have become kind of well-versed in Buddhism and have reached some kind of decently high level. One day they chose very auspicious date to go together all the way up to a mountain, very far. The name of the mountain is God's Mountain. Yeah. So that they will become a Buddha. They think their time has come and they should become Buddhas. Very. So they went together to that mountain. If you are high level already, if you go to that mountain, you will become a Buddha. It's very, very far away. So many, many years of hardship and traveling long distance. One day, they arrived at the mountain. They were so tired. There's no way to describe how tired they are. But all of them are determined in their goal, thinking, we are already here at the foot of the God's Mountain, and we cannot just give up. Thus, even though the evening is already there and the sun has set behind the mountain, they still try very hard to follow the little path, the dirt path, to go all the way up to the mountain top. When they were on top of the mountain, the night already late, and the whole sky and the surroundings were as dark as black ink. All of them are very, very hungry and exhausted. They can no longer continue. The hunger and the exhaustion forces them to stop and take a rest, but none of them can sleep.
Suddenly one of them say, "Oh my God, if right now we have like a magic wand so that we can wish for something, wouldn't that be good?" So the others say, "Yeah, suppose we have that magic wand, a wishful feeling wand, what would you like to eat then?" So one of them, too hungry and too tired, cannot even control his mind or speech. Oh, not just one of them, all of them are like that. So no matter what they like, even though they are monks and nuns,
They just like blurt it all out what they want without any caution anymore because they're too tired and too exhausted. One of them say, oh, I wish I had some dog meat now to eat. Oh God. But along with the dog meat, there should be sufficient and proper condiment, like all kinds of herbs, etc. And the second one just cut him off and say, oh, I would like to have a meal with beefsteak. Even if the ox or the cow is already old, it's even better, so I can chew longer. And third one said, oh, I would just like to have a chicken with lemon leaves. Finally, the nun said to them, no, I would like to have just a meal with boiled vegetables. And then I can drink the boiled water. That will be good enough for me. It will quench my thirst as well as my hunger. Mm. So they all lay down without anything. Just imagine that. Have nothing to eat. In the morning, they all woke up and then prepared to continue to go. Then suddenly there was an old man with very white hair and a white beard with a walking stick coming from the middle of the mountain. He looked very tired, but his voice was very, very crispy and clear still. Hey, where have all of you come from? So one of them say, ah, elderly, we, the monks and nuns, we want to come up to the God's mountain so that we can become Buddhas. Yeah. Could you please show us the way, if you know? So the old man said, of course, I can. I can bring all of you to the God's mountain. But now you have to spit onto these leaves. After that, the old man took out from his shoulder bag four budi leaves. You know, the budi leaves are supposed to come from the budi tree. The budi tree is one of the trees that the Buddha sat before he sat to meditate nonstop until he became Buddha. So they spit onto these leaves. And all of them, after they spit onto the leaves, they feel nauseated, and their stomach and their liver and everything became very, very funny. And then just in a blink of an eye, all of them vomited out. But the strange thing is that whatever they wished to eat last evening, they just vomited out that. Exactly that. So all three monks vomited out all kinds of meat, like chicken meat, cow meat, you know, beef, and then dog meat. Only the nun, she vomited vegetables. Yeah. So the old man said to them, this is already the top of the God's mountain. You are already in the Buddha's land. But here you vomited out all the animal meat, which are forbidden. So how can you call yourself a real practitioner? You cannot become a Buddha. So all three monks vomited out all kinds of meat, like chicken meat, cow meat, you know, beef, and then dog meat. Only the nun, she vomited vegetables. So the old man said to them, this is already the top of the God's mountain. You are already in the Buddha's land. But here you vomited out all the animal meat, which are forbidden. So how can you call yourself a real practitioner? You cannot become a Buddha. And then the old man pointed to the nun and said, okay, you just go alongside this path and go all the way up to the mountain top. Don't go down, go up. You're almost there. So the nun continued to follow the path to go up
to the top of the mountain. Then she became Buddha. She became Kuan Yin Bodhisattva. Kuan Yin Bodhisattva has many, many magical powers. She is powerful. She can destroy any of the bad ghosts and demons, so they don't bother the good people on the planet. From that day on, even up to this day, the family and the clan of the nun still continue to worship Kuan Yin Bodhisattva. And every New Year, whenever they worship Kuan Yin Bodhisattva in the New Year, they put out a bowl of vegetable soup. And the other three monks were feeling so ashamed that they could not become Buddhas, and then they lost all the merit that they had accumulated through their diligent and ascetic practice. So all of them became very, very sad, and then they died in the middle of the mountain. Because they died in the middle of nowhere, so nobody knew, nobody buried them. So the legend has it that whoever passes by that area, they should bring with them a handful of dirt or some stones to throw onto that area as if to make a tomb for them. And that area, people call it the Buddha's tomb, Buddha in the parentheses. And then this kind of Buddha's tomb keeps rising, rising higher and higher. It became a small hill. So people call that the Buddhist hill. That is a story of the three Buddhist monks who have not become Buddhas. From this story, we can see that if we just practice on the outside and the inside, we have not really regulated well, not really controlled well, not really became a naturally compassionate person, then no matter how long we practice or what kind of practice we do outwardly, it will not bring a lot of success. This is just a story, but it is like that, logically speaking. We have to practice from inside, within, because the Buddhas or heavens, they all know what we think, not just what we do. We cannot cheat heavens and all the divinities and the Buddhas or the saints. Thus, if we fake it like we are good practitioners, but we don't really practice well, we don't really put our heart into it, and we are not really sincere, then we are not pure enough to become a Buddha. Or at least meaning that we are not a pure practitioner. We are not the real saint. Just have the body that maybe looks like a saint, and the clothes maybe look like a saintly Buddha or monk or nun, but we're really not. So any practitioner, especially the Kuan Yin practitioners, we should consider to be absolutely pure in our motive. Otherwise, it doesn't matter how long we say we are practicing, we go nowhere. Some people will eat vegan or vegetarian, but are still thinking of meat and fish and the like. Even just to think about them is like the real thing. So these monks, they vomited out the things that they wished to eat, though they did not physically consume them, they vomited them out the same. So all the five precepts that thou shalt not kill, meaning we are vegan. But then the desire inside must also be cut. Mostly the Kuan Yin practitioners, they don't have difficulty with that. If they're sincere, they don't even think of meat or fish anymore. And even if they do, they feel very ugly and impossible to even think to eat that. And if they go to the supermarket, for example, they will try to avoid the meat and fish and animals' dead corpse area. If they have to pass by, it feels very uncomfortable. They have to pass by very quickly and don't even want to look at that because they know it came from the terror, the suffering of other beings, and that makes them feel painful also. I guess the story is very, very simple, even though my translation is not all that perfect, but you understood. And I hope that you remember that the real practice is inside, within, not the outside. That's why often,
Normally, we, the practitioners, don't tell of our inside spiritual visions. Sometimes it's okay, sometimes okay. But for good intentions, we can tell in front of the master or in the assembly not to boast. If we have the intention to boast about it, we will lose it and we won't have it again. Or even if we have it, the master power will cover it so you don't see it. So you cannot boast again about the secret of heavens. I wish all of you, no matter what situation, to continue to hold on to your faith, meditate well with all your heart, all your mind, all your sincerity, not just to benefit yourself, your family, your friends, or whomever around you, your neighbors, but also to benefit the whole world. And for that, I thank you. God bless. God bless all of us. God bless the world in time of trouble. There's not much more I can say or want to say anymore. I just wish the humanity wakes up and realizes what's good for them and what is not. Before it's too late. It's not just about their health, their well-being on this planet in their present lifetime, but it's about the next life where punishments are waiting for them in such a terrorizing manner that they could not even imagine. But it will happen if people don't change into a more benevolent lifestyle, befitting the children of God and according to the law of the universal love. Thank you to all of you for being good, for being awakened soon enough. Take care. I'm always with you. Pray God to keep you safe. Pray God for others who are still veiled by ignorance. God love.